To Know Christ, a television ministry of the Lutheran Church of Peace in Platteville, Wisconsin. Here's your host, Reverend Jeff Pedersen.
Well, today the topic is on war and peace. And so I read from Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 through 5. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as chief among the mountains. It will be raised above the hills, and all nations will stream to it. Many peoples will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, O house of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. You know, light always represents goodness, purity, God's instruction, his will, his love. Whereas darkness is just the opposite. The darkness represents evil, it represents sin, it represents injustice, it represents war, breakdown of relationships, you know, everything bad. So you got light and you've got darkness. You know, as we think, read what is written in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, "Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." In other words, it's God's desire for Jerusalem to be the city that is set up on a hill, that is a light to all of the nations. You know, you think about that spot. You know, it's something as you look at the geography, that at that time, you know, that little spot, you know, Israel is a very small nation, but why was it significant? Why did people fight over it? Why did people desire it? Is it because there's lots of oil and gold and all that there? No. Why? Because it's really it's the access. It really is that little spot that really brings continents together. You got north and south being connected there. You got east and west being connected there. And so it was kind of the stream, a flow. If people needed to go from the north to the south or the east to the west, they would have to go through this little country. And so a perfect place to be the light, to see that this is where God meets people. I remember being in Egypt, and I was looking at I was in the Valley of the Kings. That's where the pharaohs were buried. And over this large hill, or maybe a small mountain, if you'd want to call it that, on the other side there, it was one of the pharaohesses, one of the queens, Queen Hatshepsut. A little palace was there. And so there was a trail that went up to go over this little mountain. And so the question was asked of us, well, you have the option, you can either get back into the bus and they'll drive you around, or you can just walk on this trail and eventually get to where you need to be. Well, here I've been sitting in that bus for so long, and I thought, oh, going out and for a walk and getting some exercise, that's the thing to do. Well, as I was walking, it was hot. I mean, it was kind of a dry and arid, well, it's a very dry and arid climate in Egypt. That's why everything is preserved so well. But it was a hot day. And as I was walking, there'd be all of these people who live there in this area, the natives, would be there trying to sell me stuff. I mean, I'd be walking along and they'd be right there and trying to sell me all of these different things that they had made. You know, it'd be a lot of souvenir, tourist kinds of stuff. And so I'd be, you know, basically saying no to them. I mean, when you go hiking in Minnesota, you got all these flies around you. Well, in Egypt, you don't have all these flies around you, but you got all these people around you trying to sell you things to the point where I don't know what's worse. You almost want to swat them, you know, just to say, get away. But as we got to the top of this hill, with all these people trying to sell me something, at the top of the hill, there was a person with a bucket of what now is melted ice, selling bottles of Coca-Cola. And so I'll tell you what, I went into my pocket and I got some money and I bought a bottle of pop. But doesn't that make sense? Is that you sell to people what they need. And so he's the one that was making all of the sales. And see, and that's what Jerusalem is. It was in a real strategic place, meaning that there's people coming and going from all different ways, you know, passing through. But then also there are people who are just simply making the pilgrimage to Jerusalem for so many of the high festivals. And so this is, but it's also, this is where heaven would come down to earth. That's where the Holy Temple was. That's where the Ark of Covenant was. Temple was built on Mount Moriah. And Mount Moriah, that was the place where Abraham was going to sacrifice his son Isaac. And so this became the place where people would come and make their sacrifices, for instance, at the Passover festival. But this is where you would go and get God's instruction. This is where you'd hear the rabbis. This is where you would receive the love of God, the hope of God, the promises of God. And of course, what's, you know, so powerful is that just 6 miles out of Jerusalem, a little baby was born, being Jesus, born in Bethlehem, that heaven has come down to earth, that we may receive the light of God, to receive his goodness, his love. And so as I look at this passage, I mean, that's all of what this mountain is to be about. It's to be about God. It's to be about the salvation of God coming to these people. And that the salvation of God will now go to all the nations of the world. So as people are passing through, that they are receiving their salvation and they're now going to their nations with the good news of the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. It's something because in these first chapters of Isaiah, there's so much talk about the mountain of God, the holy city, Jerusalem, being a faithful city. It's the place where the temple is. It's where we go there and we are in awe of God. It's where we are receiving the Lord. And so, as I think about temples in the world, big, large cathedrals. And I know I've had the thrill of going into some of these large cathedrals, for instance, in places in Europe. And they do draw your attention to God. I mean, you can't help but go into this majestic cathedral, which I believe, you know, the architects were very inspired by God. Because when you go in, there's something about this space that does put your mind on God. The beautiful architecture, the paintings, the stained glass windows, you know, the statues, the way the light shines or comes into the cathedral. And so when I'd go over there, I was, you know, pretty much as, you know, I'd be coming over as a tourist. I'd have my camera and I'd be taking pictures saying, wow, I'm at this very famous cathedral. It's known throughout the world. How awesome is that? And so basically I'm seeing this as being a tourist place. But then I notice that there are people walking in who are not tourists. And they're actually worshiping God. And she's like, oh yeah, that's right, I almost forgot. This beautiful building, it's, you know, I just thought it was just a wonder that everybody can come in and just, wow, look at the stained glass. Wow, look at the big domes in this cathedral. Isn't that something? And people are drawn because of all of this stuff. But then to see that people aren't drawn because there's a stained glass window in here, they're drawn because this is where they meet God. This is where they are receiving the salvation of God. And then I'm reminded, oh yeah, it's the church. That's what it's about. You know, the people, the faithful people didn't gather here for worship. Then all this would be is just a beautiful shell. So what? But this is where God meets people. It's where the word of God is proclaimed. Matter of fact, they even have times saying at these times, tourists, you're not allowed to come in here. Because this is where the people gather for worship. And as they're gathering for worship, you know, they're hearing God's word. They're receiving the sacraments. They are praying. And so, yes, a building can draw our focus on God, but then as we are in that building, then it's going deeper. Now that my focus is on God, now let me receive God. Let me receive my salvation. That Jesus is more than brick and mortar. But he's alive. Jesus Christ is risen. The Holy Spirit comes to transform our lives. And so as I think about all of this, what is it about? What is it about? It's about God. And does God have something to say? Does God have something to say upon his holy mountain? Does God have something to say in his word? Does God have something to say to you on a Sunday morning? Whereas you're having your devotions on a Tuesday afternoon. Because as human beings, we like to have a lot of the attention drawn to ourselves. I mean, that's the problem is that, you know, people want power. People want attention. People want to have fun. They want, you know, the things and the pleasures of this world. And that's what gets us into so much trouble. You know, there's a singer who I really enjoy listening to. I've got some of his CDs, and whenever his music comes on Christian radio, I like to, you know, sometimes I'll even turn it up a little bit. His name is Toby Mac. Maybe you've heard of him. He's a very popular Christian singer. And there's a song that brings tears to my eyes every time I hear it. And it's a song where he's in this particular city, and he's behind the stage. It's getting very close to the time where he's to come out and to perform. And he can hear the crowd out there chanting. You know, they're getting a little impatient. It's a sold-out crowd, and he can hear them out there. But before he goes out, he prays, remembering what this is all about. This is not the Toby Mac show. People have not come here to worship Toby Mac. But what he just says, God, Jesus, if you've got something to say, here is the stage. This is not my stage, Jesus. It is yours. Stage. I think about that so oftentimes. You know, we have talented people in the church, and they can sing, and they can speak, and they can do all kinds of things. They're wise, and they're intelligent. They can teach. And the temptation is there to think the spotlight is on me. But the question is, does Jesus have something to say today? And if Jesus has something to say today, then let's clear the stage so that Jesus can proclaim and to share with us what that is. What is the message of Jesus? Well, a message of love. A message to say, I care about you. I love you. I've got your best interests in mind. I've died on a cross. I've shed my blood for you this day. So that you may have forgiveness and that you may have eternal life. That's what this is all about. And then I want you to love one another and to live in peace. You know, as I think about all the different religions of the world, and here again, I'm a Christian, but as I've studied all the different religions of the world, it's always interesting because there is some special message in all these different religions of the world. And I'd say that for all of these people who belong to all of these different religions of the world, that if they were to abide by these teachings, that at least our world would be a better place. That there won't be war, there won't be fighting. Because in a lot of religions, the world religions, you know, you got such little simple teachings that are so profound that if everybody would just do that, this world would be a very fine place. A teaching such as, treat others in the way that you would want to be treated. You know, if you don't want somebody coming in and stealing your stuff, well then, don't you go out and steal somebody's stuff. If you don't want somebody to come and smack you in the face, well, then you don't go and smack somebody in the face. If you don't like it when people are gossiping about you and starting up and spreading all kinds of rumors, well, then you don't do that either. But then to do the very things. If you want somebody to be there to comfort you when you have heard such devastating news that one of your very special people in your life has died, well, then you go and do that for somebody today. In every community, there's somebody who's grieving. Why don't you be their comfort today? There's somebody down and out in your community today, you know, where, you know, they're working hard and they just don't have enough income to make it. Well, how can you be that extra income? What can you offer this person? Do you have an extra box of cereal food, for instance, or an extra can of soup, whatever it may be? Or to notice that as school starts, that maybe, you know, we can go and help with at least buying shoes so that, you know, the child next door will have shoes to wear to school. You know, whatever that may be. Be that to people. Be who you want other people to be to you. That seems to be a, you know, something fundamental about all religions, including the Christian religion. Jesus says that. And so I just keep thinking, well, if we just let Jesus have the stage and just share his simple principles of do unto others as you'd want them to do to you. To love the Lord your God and to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Can't we do that? Is that difficult? Well, see, and that's where it all starts. It starts from God. I mean, if you really do believe in God, well, then give your life to God. And be content in your life. No, I've got everything now. No, I don't need one more thing because I've got everything now. I've got Jesus. You know, to the point where I'm not greedy anymore, and it's not like I need more stuff, but rather I'm thankful. I'm thankful for how richly blessed I am to the point where now I'm starting to think, what can I give of myself? Okay, so we have, you know, things like pride. We have things like we want the spotlight. We want the attention on ourselves. We want power. We like things. And that's what creates all kinds of war, then, isn't it? And so there are different views as far as Christianity, as far as war goes. And one of those views is that of the pacifist view. And I'll read, you know, an argument for the pacifist view, meaning that Christians don't go to war. And I'll read that from Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 42. Jesus said, You have heard that it was said, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if someone wants to sue you and take your tunic, let him have your coat as well. If someone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Isn't that something? You know, I've always learned that it takes two to tangle, doesn't it? We always think, well, yeah, we go with that Old Testament law saying an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. We're going to make it even. But somehow it's just never even. It's just like, well, okay, this person's done this to me, and now I do something that's back, but now they interpret it saying, well, yeah, but you did more. You did a little bit more to me. And so now I come back with this, and pretty soon it's back and forth. It's like being in sports, you know, as we're playing basketball or football or whatever it is, there's a scoreboard. We got home versus the visitors, or it's me against that one. And so we see the score up there, and how is the score? Is the score even? Oh, just like that, I'm a little bit ahead. Oh, just like that, now I'm a little bit behind. How do we even the score? There's always this tug of war, this tussling going on. And so it is with life. Hey, it's not fair. This person did this to me. I'm up for justice. But can God transform our lives? Now, here again, I said that this is the pacifist view, meaning that we don't go to war. When somebody strikes us on the cheek, we turn the other one. And by turning the other one, what we are saying is that I'm not going to fight with you. In other words, you struck me, but that's where it ends. I'm not going to strike you back. And so now if you feel like you need to strike me a second time, well, I guess you're just going to have to do that then. We only have two cheeks. After they hit the one cheek and we turn the other cheek, well, then what do we turn? We turn our back to the person and say, well, now sock me in the back? I mean, how many times do you have to hit me before you feel like it's even? But I don't like necessarily calling this a pacifist view because there is an activeness to it. Is that what Jesus is saying? Okay, do good for this person. You know, we're to pray for the person that we're having problems with. Turn the other cheek, but then to do good things. Oh, the person's going to sue you for your coat? Well, give them your tunic as well. You know, if he's suing you for your car, give them your camper. You know, just to say that, okay, yeah, we got a scoreboard going on here. But the scoreboard is different, saying that I'm going to make sure I do more good things for you than what you're doing for me. I'm going to always make sure that's lopsided, that you're not going to outdo my goodness. Yeah, you can strike me in the cheek, but I'm going to do something nice for you today. And if you strike me in the other side of the cheek, well, I'm going to do two nice things for you today. And see, the whole thing of it is that after you get struck on one cheek and you get struck on the other, then pretty soon you get hit in the nose. And I don't know if you've ever broken your nose, but I'll tell you what. When you break your nose, there's lots of blood. Now we got blood here, don't we? And then that's where we point to Jesus, saying, you know what? There's one who shed his blood for us, and that is Jesus Christ. And that is what makes things even. Because we all are indebted to God. If God were to go and to strike us for every bad thing that we've done, but in a sense, even the score, we'd be so black and blue. But no, Jesus dies on the cross for us. He does his goodness. He shows his love for us when we are so undeserving of it. And so the second view would be the just war view. Okay, and so we can look at Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 3, you know, for the just war view. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist or that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong, do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. Okay, so this whole theory has to do with that we obey our government. And when there's an atrocity going on where a lot of people are hurting, this is where we are called. We may not be for war, but we are called by, God has two kingdoms, the kingdom of government and the kingdom of church. And so when the kingdom of government is calling us, for instance, to go to war, we may not like it, but that is what that calling. So that would be the just war. And then the third one would be a holy war. That's where God is, you know, in war, just claiming what belongs to him. And when we think about Joshua conquering the promised land, that'd be an example of that. That this is a holy war, it's God's war, and to me it just seems like God wages his war in love. And what God is desiring for us is to take our swords and our weapons and to melt them down and to make them into plowshares and pruning hooks. That we're not here to go to war and to destroy other nations and our neighbor, but rather we are here to build them up. Instead of weapons of war, weapons of agriculture. And so that's the whole challenge, is what am I doing to build up my neighbor? What are we doing as a nation to build up another nation, that we may be this holy city where the goodness of God is showing forth? That we are always exercising and working on building up relationships, building up each other, so that we would never go to war, and as a result, all nations of the world prosper. And that's the world that God loves, and that's the world that Jesus died for, and that's the world that Jesus wants us to have, a peaceful world.
You've been watching To Know Christ with Reverend Jeff Pedersen, pastor at the Lutheran Church of Peace, Platteville, Wisconsin. Reverend Pedersen's 12-part marriage series, The Tie That Binds, is available as a DVD box set. To learn how you can obtain the DVD box set of The Tie That Binds and its companion book, call KFXB-TV, Dubuque, Iowa, 563-690-1704. Thank you for watching this program. I'm Robert Snyder. Tune in again for To Know Christ.